Welcome. Good morning.
Good morning. Delighted to be here for Yorgi Rachmaninoff.
Well, I was listening. It's just one of the most exciting chases I've ever heard. Very, very exciting.
Yes, it's exciting, and yet it's very intense emotionally. Yeah.
But it's another dimension you gave this piece in, I don't know, in dynamics, but also in speed and rubato. It's really
I'm
wonderful.
I'm a very visual person, so I could do a movie, but I'm not going to tell what it is about. Maybe one day.
Yeah.
But the clip of this piece on YouTube, which was made by wonderful videographer, by the way, cinematographer Ali Habashi. That was our student years back in Miami. So that was, you know, like the best viewed viral clip. And that's how I started on YouTube. Because it was such a runaway success.
Because I said already in my announcement that this clip is over 900,000 viewers now.
You know, it's the quality there is not so perfect.
No.
You can see, you know, when people know the piece, it's not even synchronized.
Mm-hmm.
Because we were using different cameras. It was all student production. It was not done completely professional, not like here in studio. But yet, there was something about it that attracted lots of attention from people. You know, people not musicians. And they were looking, and I was looking at comments, you know, how people felt about this piece. And of course, I was extremely flattered.
But you have a lot of fans, I guess, or what?
Yeah. But still, you know, every time I have to prove with this piece, especially in comments for the first year about the comments, we were, oh, this is a recording which is sped up. On video, right? But that was always a story because technique is given me in such an easy way that it's not difficult for me, okay? So I have to pretend that it's difficult. And even when my recordings were out without videos, so people would say, oh, it's all, you know, edited, re-edited, and it cannot be like that. And then we decided to make video to prove that I can play like that.
Okay.
And then people started saying, but it's sped up.
Oh, really?
But the whole YouTube purpose was actually, you know, so people could see. Because at that point, we being naive, because we had no idea about videography and possibilities of it, we thought if you see video, it's not as edited, you know, with 800 takes per minute as audio is nowadays. Mm-hmm. So that was the whole idea.
But nevertheless, you're very popular on YouTube.
Yes.
And how is it in concert live?
I have so many YouTubers coming to my concert, just popping out, and they come from different countries. Like I played concerts here in Holland, and people from Hungary would come, you know, people from Japan. It's so wonderful.
Having so many fans, I thought, well, maybe it's now time for your own soap or what, you know, your reality soap.
I had a reality show. For a week, I was running camera 24 hours a day.
It Where? Was on
in my own studio over summer. Because people asked me, okay, how much do you practice? What do you do for fun? Well, I do nothing for fun. I practice for fun. And I practice between 12 and 14 hours. It's normal for me. And people wouldn't believe it. So I put web camera, and it was webcast directly. You know, with everything, you know, I would just go out, get coffee, have lunch, and it was constant camera on for 1 week. I hope that it will inspire, you know, students to go and practice more. Instead, they were sitting and watching the camera. So it was kind of silly.
Well, you practice 12 to 14 hours a day?
Whenever I have chance.
My first chance. Would you like your hands on the table for me for a moment?
Okay.
Flat, yes. Together?
Together,
put this away.
Okay.
And could you describe your hands for me?
Well, there are 10 fingers, and they're quite muscular. I call them little Schwarzeneggers. You see those muscles? Yeah, of course, all this practice time. And when I was a child, you know, I was absolutely fascinated and in love with horses. And I was not allowed to ride horses or come close, for my parents were afraid I'm going to damage my hands. So my hands were horses. You know, this one was black one, and that was my favorite. And, you know, it would do this with finger, you know, but when it wanted to run. So that's how I learned the technique. They were horses running around. And this was white with spots.
No, really?
Yes, and this is black stallion.
Okay, the left hand.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so you have a strong left hand.
Yes, they're equally. I think I'm not left-handed or right-handed.
Uh-huh. Because it's amazing the repertoire you play. But go back to your youth, when you studied at Lysenko.
Yes.
Yes. Can you recall some of these times or lessons or...
it was not terribly excited. You know, the only thing I liked about studying music is because I could come on stage and play for people. That was favorite part. Practicing was not. So I was inventing all kinds of ways, you know, to entertain myself, because I was fortunate to have, you know, photographic memory. So everything would come easily to me. So basically, like, I would learn the piece and I would put book on and I would just play something and read. And then until exam would come, then I would work for another day or so. I was quite lazy. The only thing I like it is playing.
And your teachers?
My teachers.
How was your relation with your teacher?
Awful. I would do everything opposite from my teachers, from what they would say. And they were quite upset with me. And, you know, they were different teachers, of course, because, you know, this Soviet or Russian school of, you know, piano playing or music, it was all about, at the end, about winning competitions. It was almost like a sport. So we were trained to play one program, you know, whatever. Now it's early morning, but they would wake you up in the middle of night, hang you upside down, and you'd better play your Tchaikovsky concerto every single note, because you're going to be sent eventually in competition and get a gold medal for your motherland. That's how it was. So, and yet it was not a sport, because you didn't know how people exactly win competitions, what it takes.
Of course, yeah.
Because after all, in music, you know, it's not about who plays the fastest scales, who plays the cleanest, you know, loudest octaves. It's about music. And in the end, you are not competing. And that's very difficult realization to come to. And that's why I got fascinated with, you know, with different kinds of sports. And of course, yeah, you know about chess, right?
You played chess when you were small?
Yes.
Okay.
But I have to give disclaimer, because in Russia, chess was a spectator sport, sort of, you know, like football here. You know, actually...
Really?
Yes, in every news, you know, between weather, which is the most important thing people would watch, they were given, you know, all the reports about chess games. It was weird. But actually, my inspiration to play chess came... You remember that famous match with Karpov and Kasparov, which continued forever, and, you know, but that was such a great lesson for me as a child, which I always remember it. And I didn't know about chess, and I didn't care. But what I cared about, you know, if you tried to feel good about being underdog, and for a person to come up from the most difficult circumstances, that what it was when Kasparov, who was just 1 point from being eliminated from this game, he came out and he actually won it. He would have won it. So, you know, it's like a lesson in life, like never, ever give up. And after that, I got fascinated with chess. So, and chess being sport, as you remember, I told you, it was very easy, clear, you know, everything was black and white. If you're better than your opponent, you win. In the worst case scenario, you get a draw, but it's not like music, it's unambiguous. If you are stronger, if you know more. So that's what attracted me in chess, okay?
But you have to make a choice one day or what, becoming professional, or it
happened gradually, because if I'm asked, okay, when did I started liking music more than chess? And it didn't happen in one day or 1 month, but I started, you know, when I was maturing, you know, going through teenage years, I started changing from this person, you know, very competitive person to person where emotions and feelings would come up. So I started noticing that in chess games, when I was playing, you know, and I had vivid imagination. So if I would be playing and suddenly, you know, if I would have, you know, white bishop, and instead of doing the best move, bishop would fall in love with black queen, and he would decide, you know, to be a traitor to his side, and something like that, you know, all those weird things. So I was looking for the most beautiful moves instead of winning moves. And that's when I knew that I have to stop chess.
Valentina, I thank you very much for being here.